Good evening, everyone. We're at the fag end of the day, and we have a session that I'd like to keep you awake. After this invigorating talk on diabetes, my two predecessors talked to you about the injectable therapy. I'm going to throw some insight into the modern management of diabetes with OH oral hypoglycemic drugs. We are always vexed at what to choose and what are the best agents in each situation. So keeping that in mind, I'm going to discuss a few possibilities and what are the new current thoughts and opinions about taking the right OHA. So as I said, I'm starting with the case discussion. It's a 38-year-old male who's been diabetic for 2 years. He's weighing 69 kg with a high BMI. He's on metformin 1 gram BD. And he's got HbA1c of 8.2, which is pretty high, not well controlled. Fasting of 155 and postprandial of 260. And his blood pressure is 134/82 and the eGFR is 104. So this gentleman obviously is not well controlled on the present OHA, that is metformin 2 gram. Needs some more intensive treatment so that his HbA1c can come down to at least below 7. So this will keep your thought process thinking what next to give after metformin. And then again, if you see the second case, this patient definitely is uncontrolled on metformin, as you see. So in this stage, you have to realize that metformin is not enough and you have to add a second line drug, which could be either a DPP-4 inhibitor or a sulfonylurea or something alpha-glucosidase inhibitor or even SGLT2 inhibitors. What is the next step and how do you decide what to do? That is the thing to bear in mind. Again, if you see the second case, here also there's a 51-year-old male who's been diabetic for 5 years, but he has a positive history, family history of CAD. And he's on already taking DPP-4 inhibitor plus metformin combination. His HbA1c is still running high at 7.8. His fasting is 104, postprandial 190. His BP is a little on the high side. His GFR is normal. Here again also you see that his control is not adequate. He's uncontrolled on two drugs, which is metformin and DPP-4. So definitely he needs to have a third agent. He needs to go for a triple therapy to keep his sugar under control so that he can prevent the micro and the macrovascular complications. So what is the third line drug that we choose? It is the sulfonylurea, or you go for SGLT2 or thiazolidone or GLP-1 agonist, or go for insulin, basal insulin. That is the thing we have to ponder at this point, and I'll be presenting some arguments in favor of the new OHAs and the new trials that we have, and so that we can make up our mind what will be the best oral hypoglycemia at this instance. As you know, decision making is important. What should be the target HbA1c? All of you know it should be at least below 7 or preferably near 6.5. Can we reach the target HbA1c by addition of single agent in the first case? The patient only was on metformin. So probably if you choose a judicious drug, possibly SGLT2 or a DPP-4, you can achieve that. And what should be your approach in the high severity second case? Because the patient has already had a heart disease, so then that patient, we have to choose an antidiabetic drug which has got proven cardio safety and will help the cardiac standpoint, which is very much relevant in today's SGLT2 inhibitors. As you know, diabetes, hyperglycemia contributes to heart disease, and both CKD and cardiovascular disease, patients with diabetes have twice the risk of heart disease compared to general population. And CKD is also estimated to affect almost 50% of diabetic patients. And you know that maintaining glycemic target can be difficult to achieve. As you see from this graph, many of the patients who have had therapy, the ones which have got high HbA1c, which are running more than 7, they fare poorly compared to the ones who are well controlled. So glycemic control over the period of time tends to decline over the years. And as the HbA1c keeps on creeping high, the complications also start to grow. So keeping that in mind, you have to really be aggressive from the beginning. You have to act fast from the beginning and achieve a more aggressive approach. Indian patients with diabetes normally do not achieve the perfect HbA1c, which should be near about 6 to 7, ideally 6.5. Only 25% patients are in that age group. Most of the Indian patients are lying above the 7% mark. Most of them are in the near about the 8 to 9% group, which is not very good from the Indian scenario. And why is it important to control the HbA1c? As you know, that initially, the diabetic control is very important initially when diet and exercise fails. You try and start therapy with one drug, then if that doesn't, then you titrate the dose of the drug. If that doesn't, then you add a second drug, double drug. And then if it doesn't work, then you can go for basal insulin or third drug. And ultimately, everything fails, you go for multiple daily dose of insulin. So whatever step of the disease you are in, you have to make sure that the HbA1c is well controlled so that you can prevent the long-term complications of the disease. So you see that in that therapy, if you can start with from the very beginning rather than waiting till the end, if you can from the very beginning rather than depending on one drug, if you can go for two drug combination, that will be very effective in controlling the HbA1c. Wikipedia has also shown conventionally that from the very beginning, if you start intensive therapy compared to conventional, the intensive therapy group, the chance of complication is much less if your H1C is controlled and they maintain a better safety level over a long period of time. This has been well proven by the Wikipedia study, as you know. With poor glycemic control, the risk of complication increases, as we see. HbA1c, the more it goes up, and initially, the more is the risk of complications. Both cardiac and renal complications tend to rise. And we are more worried about the cardiovascular complications due to atherosclerosis if your diabetes is not well controlled. So therefore, what I'm trying to say is that clinical inertia is defined as a lack of treatment, intensification in a patient, not at evidence-based goal for care, that is failure of healthcare providers to initiate or intensify therapy when indicated. That is an important thing you have to bear in mind, that healthcare providers, from the very beginning, people should not take a lackadaisical attitude. They should be very aggressive. And if you see that your HbA1c is not well controlled, if it's less, more than running more than 8 or 9%, and the patient is running into complications rather than waiting and keeping on the same dose of drugs, metformin or lifestyle, you should think of adding a second or even a third drug to control the HbA1c and achieve better results. And what is the goal should be also to avoid hypoglycemia. We should choose a drug which has least chance of hypoglycemia. It causes less weight gain, especially with oral drugs, along with lifestyle modification, which is with there. After lifestyle, we go for metformin. If metformin doesn't work, then you usually choose from either of the six agents, as I talked about, which could be sulfonylurea, thiazolidone, DPP-4, GLP-1, SGLT-2, or insulin. But now I'm highlighting the DPP-4 and SGLT-2 because the current evidences and trials that have been shown, the cardio safety and the renal trials are focusing more on this SGLT2, and that is why it is coming up into prominence, and now it is going to come up as well as a first-line therapy also. And listen, these have been the guidelines of ADI and ESD that for treatment, as the ominous octet control is important, there are a lot of multiple defects in diabetes treatment, and you have to control each of the steps. It is not just the beta cell failure or lack of secretion of insulin, or insulin increased insulin resistance, it is also the defect which lies at the tissue level or at the renal tubular level. So this has been shown by my previous speaker, hyperglycemia is due to multiple causes, and you have to tackle each of the causes to achieve effective glycemic control. So this ominous octet needs to be tackled, and each of the drugs are acting at different stages of the ominous octet, as you see from this graph. And SGLT2 is coming up because it is acting on a different pathway, the renal tubular cells, by causing more, inhibiting glucose reabsorption, and thereby lowering the blood sugar. So if you see the flow chart of the drugs and what they do, the results with metformin, DPP-4, and SGLT2 are the most impressive because the overall performance of these three drugs are very good compared to the others that we had, like sulfonylurea or alpha-glucosidase or GLP-1. So I'm going to focus a little bit on this combination. Metformin, as the first case, if you remember, is already taking metformin. So as a second line, probably it will be better to go on a sulfonylurea, which one to choose? Probably a sulfonylurea or DPP-4 or SGLT2. I think a fixed dose combination of DPP-4 and SGLT2, which is the best two drugs which I showed after metformin, could be a better option to fill in the gap. Why is DPP-4 important? Because DPP-4 acts in different mechanisms. They're weight neutral. They also, the SGLT2 are very good because they also help in lowering blood sugar by different mechanisms. And there's minimum or no hypoglycemia. And weight loss is also another important feature of SGLT2. So this combination, empagliflozin or linagliptin, for example, one of the DPP-4 plus SGLT2, the ideal combination, and the advantage of this combination is that if you take two drugs in one pill, patient compliance is better and the patient can achieve better results. So after metformin, you can already go for this two-drug combination. And as I said, this combination of DPP-4 and SGLT2 is doing wonders, and we can definitely try this combination so that the patient achieves a good glycemic control and he can be free of all the complications of the disease. So now I'm focusing on this empagliflozin-lenagliptin combination, fixed dose combination after using metformin. And it has been seen from the trials that I'm showing here that higher efficacy of a fixed dose combination is there over the monotherapy. Empagliflozin-lenagliptin, when given in a combination, the HbA1c reduction was much better compared to when they used separately. In the separate results, the HbA1c reduction was very low, more or less than 1%, but here the combination after being used, the reduction was very high. So you see, so 3 to 5 times probability of reaching goal HbA1c with a fixed dose combination is there compared to monotherapy. This has been well shown from these slides, as you see. On top of metformin, if you have to add a second drug, it's better to go for a dual therapy rather than choosing each separately. And the Asian study has also shown there is up to 1.2 reduction of HbA1c with empagliflozin combination replacing linagliptin alone or as an add-on to metformin, which is very statistically significant. So combination of empagliflozin and linagliptin as a second-line therapy in subjects with type 2 diabetes, inadequately controlled on metformin, is the talk of the day. Why is it important? Because these results suggest that immediate use of triple therapy in patients who have failed on metformin may provide advantage over the traditional staggered treatment approach. The traditional approach was that build up metformin further, go up to 2.5, then add a low dose of sulfonylurea, then give this. But rather than that, after metformin, if it fails, then you give the dual therapy, it is better. Why is this combination preferred? This combination has got a lot of pleiotropic benefits beyond glycemic control. As I said, body weight reduction is another important feature of SGLT2 inhibitors, and most of the patients of type 2 diabetes are obese. So if you can achieve body weight reduction in addition to glycemic control, it's definitely better. A significant systolic and diastolic blood pressure reduction is also achieved with SGLT2 inhibitors, especially any of the gliflozins, EMPA. Gliflozin is one of the prototype things. And this has been well, the cardiac safety has been well shown from the Carmelina study. The 3-point MACE reduction was very significant with this group compared to the placebo group. And the less chance of cardiac event and similar cardiac safety was seen compared with placebo. So as I said, in the first case, if I go back to that first case, the patient was uncontrolled on optimum dose of metformin with more than 8% HbA1c. The first option after metformin, what to use as a second line, probably I would go for a metformin, after metformin DPP-4 after that, or sulfonylurea, rather than metformin sulfonylurea. In this combination, after the patient was already taking SGLT2, better to go for empagliflozin linagliptin. Because the single agents, it is better to, because they achieve better HbA1c, better pleiotropic effects, less chance of hypoglycemia, and less chance of side effects. And there is proven cardiovascular and renal safety. Again, the second case also, as you see, the better to go for this combined pill of empagliflozin and linagliptin, because that has got better effect on the system, better HbA1c reduction, as I said. So management of hyperglycemia and type 2 diabetes, now it's a talk, so we have to choose the judicious combination of drugs. And no therapy is, every case is different. You have to individualize your therapy. If the HbA1c is higher than 10, definitely go for insulin. But if the HbA1c is lying between 8 to 9, after metformin, then probably you have to choose between SGLT2 inhibitors and DPP-4 inhibitors, because they're a very safe drug. They're safe from the cardiac viewpoint. And now the new recent ADA guidelines have also said that glucose-lowering medication, if you see, is very small. It has been shown by my previous speaker that most of the diabetic patients have got atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. If atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease is there as a first line after metformin, SGLT2 inhibitors are coming up in a big way, along with insulin GLP-1 analogs. And even if the patient is obese, as a secondary prevention also, SGLT2 inhibitors are coming up. So there's compelling need to minimize hypoglycemia. So in that case, also DPP-4 and SGLT2 is scoring better than the other drugs. This study has been shown clearly that SGLT2 and DPP-4 can be combined to reach target HbA1c in majority of case scenario. So glucose-lowering agents and CVD, if I do a summary, now again we can say that what are the proven anti-diabetic drug with cardio protection? In addition to SGLT2, the other injection is GLP-1 agonist, liraglutide, semaglutide, or dulaglutide, are recommended in type 2 diabetic patients because they reduce the cardiovascular risk. Again, SGLT2 inhibitors, as I said, empagliflozin, canagliflozin, or dapagliflozin are recommended in patients with diabetes and CVD, but they also have a very good cardioprotective effect and they reduce the cardiac risk. These were the findings of a recent European Congress study on glucose-lowering agents. This was just published in 2019. Again, if you see the new treatment algorithm as proposed by the ESC, that initially after lifestyle diet, we go for metformin, but now they're saying even at the very initial stage, if the patient has got proven obesity or cardiovascular disease, even as a primary prevention, you can go for SGLT2 inhibitors or GLP-1 analog from the very beginning, because this will have a more cardioprotective effect and this will control the blood sugar in a more better and more effective way. So that is the new guideline proposition, and these, even a lot of our cardiologist friends and nephrologists are also choosing SGLT2 and inhibitors in management of diabetic patients with CKD or heart disease, because they have been shown to have proven benefit on both the renal and the cardiac system. So the benefits, as I was saying, with empagliflozin in a combination is that they assess multiple pathophysiologic defects. As I said, diabetes is a multifactorial disease, and you have to control each of the steps in managing diabetes. High efficacy has been providing significant reduction in HbA1c. That is the most important thing that is required. HbA1c has to be lowered very significantly. And the lower the HbA1c, the lower is the chance of your microvascular and macrovascular complication. 1% reduction of HbA1c will cause about a significant improvement in reducing microvascular complications like retinopathy, nephropathy. An early achievement of glycemic goal with durable efficacy is the thought, is the order of the day. You should not wait long for the patient to just lay, it should not be an inertia. And 3 to 5 times higher odds of patients reaching the goal HbA1c compared to individual agents. Rather than using one drug after metformin, it's better to go for a combination of two drugs which will achieve HbA1c more faster and effectively and prevent the long-term complications. It offers significant weight reduction. That is why most of the patients are obese, and if you can choose a drug like SGLT2 or GLP-1 analog, they can cause weight loss and patients will be very happy. Also, they offer significant systolic and diastolic blood pressure reduction, which I said. BP lowering is also another important plus point, extra benefit, glycemic effect, and the blood pressure is well reduced. Empagliflozin has got cardiorenal protection and CV death reduction, along with linagliptin. All the gliptins, all the glyphosates act on that, and absence of any additional safety concerns, along with potential of lower side effect, and the convenience of once daily pills. So you see, there are multiple advantages of this combination. So in our modern scenario, when you're managing type 2 diabetes patients, you don't go by the traditional approach of going for metformin, after that give sulfonylurea, after that with alpha glucosidase. Nowadays, there's two new drugs, SGLT2 and DPP-4 to some extent, but mostly SGLT2 and is coming up in a big way, and that is changing the therapy of diabetes management because it is giving us more advantages. Besides extra glycemic control, it is also helping us to reduce the burden of heart disease and also preventing the patient from having heart disease-related complications. Thank you for your patient hearing. Yeah.